عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. فلما ذهبوا به وأجمعوا أن يجعلوه في غيابة الجب وأوحينا إليه لتنبئنهم بأمرهم هذا وهم لا يشعرون. وجاءوا أباهم عشاء يبكون. قالوا يا أبانا إنا ذهبنا نستبق وتركنا يوسف عند متاعنا فأكله الذئب وما أنت بمؤمن لنا ولو كنا صادقين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Today I hope to discuss ayahs number 15 to 17 with you. That's the next sort of step in the story as Allah tells it. But there are two outstanding things that were brought to my attention that, you know, I wanted to make mention of, and I think they're significant enough that they should be brought to our attention. In discussing the previous ayat, when I was telling you that the brothers were making a really compelling case to the father, and the father somehow seems that he's given into the idea that he's going to let them go. Again, the question lies, why would the father drop his guard? And part of that is something, you know, my wife Valerie brought up, and I think that I should have brought it up yesterday, so I'm bringing it up today. And that is that, you know, a lot of times you have people with good intentions, like the father has good intentions, and his love is pure for his children. He means well. And his children know that his intentions are pure. And when you have good intentions and you have sincere love for someone, you want to see them be good. That's what you really want for them to be good, right? And even if reality is staring at you in the face, telling you otherwise, that they're heading in a dark direction, somehow in your heart, you're holding on to the hope that they're going to walk away from that dark path and they're going to take the right steps. So when they're convincing you that they're going in the right direction, or they've had a change of heart, then there's already a bias inside you because of the goodness you have in you, because you want to see good in them, that you kind of, almost see what you want to see. You see, you tell yourself that maybe this time they are different. Maybe this time they are not going to be like before. And maybe my hope, my desire for them to become better or to not have this evil inside them and this jealousy or this spite inside of them or that rage, that unjustified rage that they have inside them, maybe they've actually let that go because you'd really like to see it that way. So they're taking advantage of that love that really Yaqub alayhi salam has. And a lot of times, this is important to mention because, you know, people sometimes, because of their benefit of the doubt and them wanting to see good in people, are unwilling to see glaring reality. Like reality staring at you in the face and it's speaking to the contrary, but you just want to keep giving benefit of the doubt. And of course, people come back and say, those who are taking advantage of your benefit of the doubt say, well, Allah is the judge. Whatever I did in the past, Allah is the judge, Allah forgives, I've made tawbah from that. So that's one thing I wanted to highlight before I start today. There are two judges. There's Allah as the judge, and He is the ultimate judge, and He can forgive whatever. He can forgive people that have committed murder. He can forgive shirk. He can forgive any crime. That's Allah Azza wa Jal. But human beings are also, in a limited capacity, judges in this world. So if somebody has been, for example, hurting you, or somebody has been abusing you over and over again, and then they finally say, I've made tawbah. Well, their tawbah is, their repentance is between them and God, them and Allah. But that doesn't mean you have to give them the opportunity to put yourself in a vulnerable position again. They violated your trust over and over again. And even if they've changed course or they've become a better person, well and good. I'm not judging whether you're going to hell or not. But I'm not going to put myself in a difficult position just because you've made tawbah. They don't necessarily, their sincerity of tawbah doesn't necessarily mean that you have to open up the doors of trust yet again. Trust has been violated, it has to be earned back, and maybe it'll never be earned back, right? And if you know better, this is not to say, well, don't you believe Allah forgives? Yeah, Allah forgives. And you can even forgive, but that doesn't mean you won't be cautious anymore. You have to be cautious. I'm getting ahead of myself, but later on in the story, you know, these brothers, they felt bad about what they did, and they came to the father and said, could you pray for us to forgive, for Allah to forgive us? You know, they didn't even apologize to their dad in the language of the Quran. I guess it's embedded, it's implied, but they told their dad, could you, you know, when all was said and done, when the story gets resolved at the end, they told their father, you know, pray for us, for Allah to forgive us. And their father, You know, he said something remarkable. He said, "Sawfa astaghfiru lakum Rabbi. Innahu huwal ghafurur rahim." I will eventually ask Allah to forgive you. Like, he doesn't say, "Yes, let me pray for you now." He said, "I will." Because he can't get himself to do it right away. I mean, you guys, you lied about your brother. You schemed, you tried to kill him. You kept this from me for all these years, and it's all just coming out now. And now you come to me and say, make dua for us. Ask Allah to forgive us. Hold on a second, let me process this a little bit. No, but don't you believe Allah forgives? And He says it. Innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. Allah is the one He forgives. Of course, Allah is the one who forgives. But I am not over it yet. Hold on a second. Right? So there's a line drawn between human ability to overlook something and wipe this, you know, the slate clean, and Allah who wipes the slate clean. Allah can wipe the slate clean for anybody. Now, even compared to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we know that in Islam, when you make tawbah, or if you were non-Muslim and you accepted Islam, that's considered a tawbah, a repentance, a turning back to Allah. You know what that means? All your previous sins are forgiven, right? That's the principle that we have in our religion. So nothing of your past is held against you. And then you have the case of, you know, the Habashi, the Wahshi, the slave, who had actually speared Hamza radiallahu anhu. Right? And when he speared him, he was on the opposite enemy end, and he was buying his freedom to spear the Prophet's uncle. And he speared him, he got him through the back. And when he killed him, eventually, years later, Wahshi has accepted Islam. And he's still afraid for what he's done. And when he finally came face to face with the Prophet ﷺ, he actually cloaked himself, because he thought that if people see him even from the outskirts of Mecca, after the conquest of Mecca, people will kill him. Right? So he cloaked himself and disguised himself, and people were coming in line to greet the Prophet ﷺ and take shahada and say salams or whatever. So his turn comes, and he uncloaks himself, and the Prophet ﷺ asks, "Are you him?" And he confirms that that's him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, "Allah has forgiven, but I don't want to see you again." Right? So even the Rasul of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, like, he knows that Allah has forgiven his sin, right? He knows that. But a human being is still a human being. Ar-Rabbu Rabbun wa in tanazzal, wal-Abdu Abdun wa in taraqqa. The principle is the master remains the master even if he comes down to the first heaven, he's still the master. And a slave will always be a slave even if he goes to the seventh heaven, he's still a slave. Right? So we cannot be like Allah in this. We can't. And you shouldn't manipulate what Allah does when He forgives and then expect people to forgive in the way that Allah forgives. That's unfair. That's not what the Quran is calling for. The point that I'm making here is, yeah, you can. Not because somebody made one mistake, but if there's a pattern of abusive behavior, and it's clear that Yaqub alayhi salam is noticing a pattern of behavior from his sons, that at this point, if he is not going to be forgiving them, you know, if he's going to pass judgment on them, that they are probably prone to bad behavior, then they can say, "Are you questioning our tawbah?" No, nobody's questioning your tawbah, but human beings can only go by pattern of behavior. You know, there's a reason when somebody comes out of jail in any country, any society, when they come out of jail or they get released early, they're on probation period, aren't they? Because if they've got a few strikes on them, or they've got a certain behavior, even though you've paid for your crime, legally you're out, but there's fear of a tendency you might still have. Right? And that tendency is acknowledged by this probationary period. Right? So that's actually just the way human beings have to deal with each other. And you don't bring Allah into that and say, "No, Allah forgives, why can't you?" That's manipulative. Okay? So that's one observation from the last discussion that I wanted to add. Another observation, someone sent it to me by email and I thought it was valuable, was also when I talked to you about the wolf and how there's a duality possibly in the meaning of the wolf, and the wolf could also represent, you know, the devil inside of them, right? It could also be that one of the ways to read that ayah, one of its figurative, you know, implications, is I fear that the wolf will eat him while you are unaware of him. The him could be the wolf, meaning you're not even aware that it's shaitan destroying your brother through you, right? You're unaware not just of your brother when you're running around, but you're unaware of the work shaitan is using you for. And this is very powerful, because a lot of times the devil gets us to do things, and in our head it's our own doing, or we're thinking it. But he's actually pulling the strings, he's manipulating our thoughts, and he's feeding us ideas, and we're buying them lock, stock, and barrel, thinking that they're our own thoughts. But anyway, so now let's move on to where we're at today. The father's been now convinced to let him go, even though he's worried, he's regretting that he reluctantly made that decision. And eventually they're able to pull him away. Now I'm saying eventually, I enunciated that slowly because the Arabic word is falamma. Lamma is for tarahi in Arabic. You could translate that as when, then when, or so when, but there's lots of Arabic words in the Quran that translate into the English word when. The word lamma would be closer to finally when, eventually when. So there's also inside of that word a pulling and a tugging implied that it wasn't easy for even after convincing dad to get him away. Right? But eventually they were able to pull this off, and that morning they got away. ذَهَبُوا بِهِ When they finally, you know, took him away. When they finally took him away, did away with him. وَأَجْمَعُوا أَن يَجْعَلُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبِّ And they all came to a consensus. They gathered around this idea, or they all ganged up to place him in the depths of the well. Now, أَجْمَعُوا أَن فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبِّ also deserves some discussion. Ajma'a can mean they all, you know, gathered together. It can also mean they came, you know, what's called consensus. They all came to agreement. But we've already known that they came to an agreement. One reading, Sheikh Suhaib thinks it's a weak way to read it. I still see maybe there's some possibility, Allahu A'lam, is that they took him away, but they've taken him away. They're out in the wilderness. And the guy who suggested, one of them suggested, can we just kill him? Let's just get this done. And some of them are like, what are we doing? This is too much. We shouldn't be doing this. Maybe they're having second thoughts. And so they have to have ijma' again. Like they've taken him away and they have to reach consensus again. Okay, no, we got to do this. Okay, let's just decide what we're doing now. And can you imagine if they are doing this conversation, whether to kill him, whether to take him back, he's our brother, this is crazy. No, we can't have this anymore. This is enough. We've made up our mind. We're not going to play this game anymore. Who's listening to all of this? Their brother. He's right there talking about him like he's some sheep. And he's there as they're discussing this. That's one implication of ajma'u. The other implication is they all gather together to do away with him. What that means is one or two are grabbing him, pulling him, tugging at him. The others are keeping an eye out, you know. Others are, they're doing, like it's like a gang effort, like, you know, like a kidnapping kind of thing, you know. Because he's not quietly going down into a well. That's not what's happening. And they took his shirt, right? They took his shirt away. So this is a violent scene. And it seems all of them were involved in some way. Hold him down. Do this. Do that. And that's captured inside. أَجْمَعُوا أَنْ يَجْعَلُوهُ They all gathered together so they could put him. Push him down. Come on. Let go of my hand. They're doing this kind of struggle into the depths of the well. Now, the other remarkable thing about this is when you say when in any language, when they did this, then this happened. Right, in logic you have if and then sentences, or in language you also have when and then sentences, right? So when I start this lecture, then I'll say this, that, or the other. So there's a when part and a then part. There's a when here, when they finally took him away, and when they all ganged up to toss him, to put him inside the depths of the well. Okay, we got the when, now what are we expecting? The then. There's a jawab, lamma, you know? There's a jawab of dharf that should be coming. And there's no then. And that suggests that what they did at that time, the pain they caused, the cries that were heard, the ruthlessness, the evil on their faces, the way they were hypnotized by the devil is so unspeakable that it's not even said. It's left as a dot, dot, dot. It's almost as if the Quran is saying, can you imagine when they took him away and they all gathered and they manhandled their brother like this and they're putting him inside the depths of the well. Now, Allah could have just said the well. I told you the word well is al-jub, right? Al-jub. But Allah didn't say that. He said, أَنْ يَجْعَلُهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْ غَيَابَ means the dark part of the well. Now, this has already been said before. أَلْقُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْ Throw him in the dark part of the well. Why keep mentioning the dark part? Why not just say, put him in the well? This suggests, from our point of view, you see, in their head, they're like, at least we didn't kill him. Right, so we're not that bad. We just kind of just put him in a well. And Allah, in the way He expresses what this event is saying, can you imagine the dark part of the well, of the unfinished well? That's what they did to their brother. As if they're telling themselves is not so bad, but Allah is reiterating the phrase dark part of the well as if Allah is expressing His disgust at the act. At how heinous that was, how ruthless and how merciless that was, that they did that to their brother. أَنْ يَجْعَلُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْ أجمعوا أن يجعلوه في غيابة الجب. They all gathered together against the child to put him in that well. Like, can you imagine if dad found out? Just imagine for a moment, if dad found out that's what they did. And dad is now reiterating, sometimes when you get caught doing something, you know, if you get caught, for example, cheating on a test, and then your parents find out, and your mom says, You cheated on the test? And you're telling me you've been studying hard? You know what parents do? They go over the mistake, and they walk you through the embarrassing thing you did, and you're like sinking inside your soul as you're being walked through the mistake you made, right? Because you have to, let's go back to the videotape, right? That's what happens. You have to replay the crime, but you have to say it in a way that melts the people that are incriminated, right? If the dad found out, what would he have said? You put my baby, you put this boy, what did he ever do to you? You put him in that well, all the way in that dark, that pit. You wouldn't go there yourself, and you put him there. That's, you would imagine this kind of tone, right? But it's not the father who's taking that tone. Who's taking that tone? Allah himself. Allah is offended at this crime. And now think about where this crime is happening. This crime is happening in the wilderness. There are no video cameras. There's no security. There's no police. There's nobody. And this crime is happening, and nobody's going to find out what happened. The only witnesses to the crime are the criminals themselves. It's the only witnesses. How many crimes happen in the world and nobody's seen? They happen behind closed doors. They happen in the wilderness. Nobody ever finds out. People find entertainment in these things nowadays. It's sickening. People make TV shows about missing persons and they like watching it like it's a mystery drama, right? And they found the bones here and this and there, and we'll be back right after these commercials. It's a human person. It's a person, a family you're talking about. And it's turned into entertainment. But you know what? Who was witness to all of it, and who's disgusted by any one of those crimes? Who's angered by the crime committed against the innocent, and particularly in this ayah, crimes committed against children? You know? To the point where Allah is so specific, in the depth of the well you put this boy, وَأَنْ يَجْعَلُهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبِ. And as he's being put, how traumatized the child must be that his own brothers are doing this to him. That they're pulling at him. Stop, don't do that. And he must be crying. There could be other, you know, we imagine, because we have this image of like prophets as very mellow, calm, embodiment of wisdom, you know, that when they put him in the well, he said, Alhamdulillah, and he just kind of, like, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown in the fire and he was calm about it, right? But even then, what did Allah do to Ibrahim alayhi salam to calm him? He, ya narukuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. Fire, become cool and peace for Ibrahim. Well, he did something similar to this boy, alayhi salam. He's being thrown inside this well, tossed down there, and as he's being put down there, Allah says, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِ, and we reveal to him, we inspire to him. Now imagine this. This is like one of the most wild scenes in the story. You've got a boy being grabbed and tugged and forced down a hole, and while he's being forced down a hole, the angel Jibreel is coming to him and talking to him. While he's not even in control of his limbs, because much bigger brothers are grabbing a hold of him, not letting him touch any, be even able to secure himself. And as this is happening to him, Allah is revealing to him, لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ بِأَمْرِهِمْ هَذَا وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. You will absolutely be telling them about this one day, what they've done here. And they have no idea. They'll have no idea. Like, as he's being put in the well, as he's being manhandled, as he's being abused, Allah is revealing to him that you are going to have the upper hand, and you will be telling them in great detail about this crime. You know? Because, you know, for a child, when they get hurt in some way, you know what the first impulse is? I'm going to tell dad. Wait till mom finds out. You know? And I'm going to tell what happened to me. And Allah says, no, you won't get that chance as a child, but one day you will get a chance and you'll be telling them what they did. You're going to be informing them. لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ بِأَمْرِهِمْ هَذَا وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. And they have no idea. Now, what, this last part, and they are not the ones that have any realization. This could mean a few things. It means, first of all, right now, it's like they're not even in their senses. It's not even, you know, يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ. The Quran says, it's like you're touched by the devil. Like at that point, you're not even yourself. They have no realization of what they're doing. Their compass of right and wrong, mercy, these qualities that Allah put inside human beings that come naturally to us, you know, to care for a child, to not want someone to suffer. That's a human quality. That's not, you don't have to be Muslim to have that quality. You just have to be human. You have to have consciousness to have that quality. Where human beings are called ins for a reason, because we have uns, we have compassion. Where is their compassion when they're doing this? It's gone. They have no realization of it. Another implication of it is, وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ, they have no idea. As they're doing this, the mighty Jibreel alayhi salam is right there too, talking to Yusuf. So he's speaking to his heart while they're yelling at him, while they're manhandling him. And they have no idea who they're messing with. They're messing with a prophet of Allah. They have no clue what they're doing. You know? You're going to find this dichotomy in the Quran. You know, in Judgment Day, the baby girl, because the ancient Arabs used to think that it's embarrassing to have a daughter, right? So they used to bury, some of them used to bury their baby girls alive. And those baby girls that were buried alive on Judgment Day will come back to life. And وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ, when that baby girl will be questioned, what crime were you killed for? What did you ever do to be killed? She'll be asked that question. Those innocent victims that had no voice, that nobody advocated for, that nobody stood up for, that had no security, they did have security, and those criminals had no idea that they had security all along. And so, وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Another implication of وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ is eventually, when he comes before them, they're going to be standing there, like they're about to get, you know, more grain and more food, and all of a sudden Yusuf alayhi salam is going to drop, do you remember what you did to Yusuf and his brother? Do you recall what you did to Yusuf and his brother? And all of a sudden it's going to, because they don't know what's coming, right? It's kind of like left hook out of nowhere. So they're just standing there, they think they're going to get food, and all of a sudden Yusuf alayhi salam is the minister, and he's going to say this to them, and their face is going to change like, oh, wait, you? You're Yusuf? Like it's going to dawn on them and they had no clue. Like they're going to be completely clueless before you hit them with this the next time, you know, when you have that final encounter with them. So that's what Allah has revealed to them, to Yusuf alayhi salam. Now they've done this unthinkable crime, and it's like that sentence was left unanswered. Even after they did it, you can imagine them hearing his cries. You can imagine, or maybe Yusuf alayhi salam calmed down after the revelation happened, right? Maybe he's quiet. And even if you're, just put yourself, I know this is crazy, put yourself, imagine yourself being one of these brothers. Just imagine yourself for a moment being one of these brothers. And you're walking away. And either you hear the silent sobs, the low voice sobs of your brother, or you hear him crying and screaming, don't leave me here. What did I ever do? I'm sorry. Or you hear nothing at all. You hear just silence. But you don't see what's happening, right? Because he's in the depth. What are you feeling? What are you thinking? Like, you have to be so far gone to think, good riddance. But if there's some humanity left inside you, you're like, what have we done? Can we just leave? Can we just, I don't want to think about it. Because if you think about it too much, you might go back and make it right. So you just want to get out of there. And you're walking away, and there's a darkness that you've allowed inside of you. And so, by the way, this idea of taking the boy out, let him run around, let him eat, let him enjoy himself and play, all of that stuff was in the daytime, right? Nobody goes in the woods at nighttime. But listen to the words, وَجَاءُوا أَبَاهُمْ عِشَاءً يَبْكُونَ. Now moving on to ayah number 16. They came to their father in the nighttime crying. They came to their father at nighttime crying. Now, it's pretty smart, they came at nighttime. Because at nighttime, even if the dad says, go back out there and find him, dad, we can't, it's nighttime. It's over, it's done with. You see, now they come at a time where they can't retrace their steps. So it's super smart. The other is, it's almost as if they can have even a better alibi. Dad, we spent the whole day looking for him and it's night, what could we do? We can't even see anymore. We looked everywhere, you know. And the amazing thing about this ayah isn't just that this clever, evil genius choice of nighttime to come back. Because they could just come back same afternoon. They could be, because if they got there in the morning, that means they can be back in the morning hours too, right? But they took their time. And they come back at night to make the story more plausible, to sell it better. But part of selling it, you can't just walk in and say, hey, well, you're right, Dad, I don't know how you guessed it. They're not going to be able to sell that. So they have to put a little emotion in it. So they come home and they're I don't know how to say it. And the dad's like, where's Yusuf? Maybe they don't know how to cry. They punch each other before they got in. And they're like, hurts. Or, as Sheikh Suhaib and I were discussing today, it may even be that some part of them is actually genuinely crying. I mean, even if they don't feel regret, you're still human. And it's a pretty emotionally traumatic thing to do what you just did. You know, even in criminology, even killers who kill and shoot people and do all that kinds of stuff, after they shoot, even though they don't feel bad, they'll still cry, some of them. They'll cry because there's a part of your humanity you can't deny, even if you're suppressing it. You'll still be in you. And now they're using those tears to present a picture to their father, coming to him crying. And what does this tell you? Before they came to father, making a case about how well-intentioned they are, how much they love Yusuf, now we're learning about diabolical liars that can fake tears. They can cry, man. They can make you feel like their world just came to an end. They're so upset. They're so sad. And that will work to their favor, because if they're crying so much, dad can't get angry at someone who's crying. Maybe dad will join them in the tears. I'll cry with you. It's okay, son. And now inside they're going, yep, got him. Right? That's the scam. Because they're selling their tears to the father. They're trying to convince him that they're broken up about what just happened. وَجَاءُوا أَبَاهُمْ عِشَاءً يَبْكُونَ I mean, this being an ayah by itself is profound to me. Like, Allah could have just skipped this part of the story. We could have just learned from Allah Azza wa Jal that they came back and told their dad a story. But Allah decided that this should be an ayah by itself, that they came to their father at nighttime crying. And the only guidance you get from this is you learn something about manipulative people who will go at great lengths to sell you a convincing story because you are used to giving benefit of the doubt. Because you're not used to questioning someone's tears. You're not used to questioning someone who says, we looked all day until it was nighttime. They're taking advantage of your tendency to want to see the good in people, and they're going to take full advantage of that and crank it all away. And there's no way you can get around that one. They're going to sell it to you good. وَجَاءُوا أَبَاهُمْ عِشَاءً يَبْكُونَ You know, the more I study the story, not even for, you know, on camera, but even off camera, as I'm contemplating the story and studying its tafsir and discussing it, you know what I come to realize? That every scene in this story is relived in millions of homes, in millions of lives, over and over again, generation after generation after generation. Every one of these scenes is alive. Fake tears are still alive. People selling all kinds of nonsense to justify or come up with a story about something that didn't happen, or make up something else that happened, create an alternative picture, because they want to manipulate and control. And their idea of love isn't love to care. Their idea of love is to control someone else's emotions, control what they think, control what they know. And the more they lie, the more they think they can control the situation. This is the common thread between people like that. They think lying can create a controlled environment. That's what they think. That's their mindset. And they'll keep lying to say, no, I'm trying to protect them. I'm trying to protect someone. That's why I'm lying. It's for their own good, you know? And so, وَجَاءُوا أَبَاهُمْ عِشَاءً يَبْكُونَ قَالُوا Now they speak. First they're crying. So that drama goes on for a while. What happened? Tell me what happened. Tell me what happened. And then eventually, now what's going to come out? Ya Abana, our dad. Dad. Abana means our father. Now the Shakespearean English translation will be, oh, our father. That's not how I would translate that. I said, Dad. I know I should teach acting class too. Okay. Inna dhahabna nastabiqu. We're telling you what really happened. The inna means certainly. Now again, here's a Shakespearean translation that doesn't connect with the emotions of the text. It would be, they said, our father, verily we went racing. Let's verily not use that and use something else. Dad, our dad, I'm telling you, not verily, I'm telling you what really happened. What really happened was we actually went racing. Nastabiqu means racing. It can also mean competing, meaning this one was gathering wood. I said I could gather more wood than that, and we kept competing with each other in different things. Istibaq could mean a race, but it could also mean we were working hard against each other to get more and more work done, and we kept drifting further and further away. Because there's more trees over there, or there's more, you know, land to graze over there, etc. So we kept drifting far and far away. That's captured inside the word dhahabna. They don't just say inna istabaqna. Inna dhahabna nastabiqu. Dhahabna, yani ba'udna. We went further and further away, and we kept competing with each other. We got so lost in our work, or in this race that we had to finish our job, or even racing, physically racing for a moment. We decided to just have a little race. وَتَرَكْنَا يُوسُفَ عِنْدَ مَتَاعِنَا. And we left Yusuf with our stuff. With our food and with our, you know, the supplies and tools or whatever. Whatever we had, we left Yusuf there for a little bit. فَأَكَلَهُ الذِّئْبُ. And by the way, when they describe this, they say, we were working so hard, Dad. We were just working so hard. We were so focused on work. You know, that's what really happened. And we were all the way out there. Then all of a sudden, fa means al-mufaja'a. All of a sudden, the wolf ate him. The wolf ate him. Then all of a sudden, the wolf ate him. Really? And so they say, فَأَكَلَهُ الذِّئْبُ وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ لَنَا. And the thing about even a wolf is, unless it's a pack of wolves, they can drag him away. Or they can drag their prey away, right? Or if they're devouring their prey, there's still something left, right? Wolves aren't big enough to devour a child whole, and there's nothing left. No bones left, no anything, nothing left. You understand? So this story that they're coming up with isn't going to add up. And that already makes no sense. It's not some massive animal that's going to devour something whole, like an alligator or something like that. Wolves are big, but they're not that big, right? And it takes them a long time to devour an animal, even a smaller animal. So they say the wolf ate him whole. أَكَلَهُ الذِّئْبُ وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ لَنَا. Now they get to the... Now so, you know, as they're saying it, I can imagine they're kind of checking Dad's reaction. Did he buy it? So the wolf ate him. And the one of them is telling it, and the other ones are checking Dad's reaction like, Did we sell it? Did we sell it? And they realize Dad's like, his face hasn't changed. His face is going from sad, shock, to upset. Maybe there's a frown. Or, you know, my kids know, I give a certain look when I don't believe what you're saying. And when there's that look, you already know you're not able to sell. I call it, for my kids, I call it, you're selling cake. Right? And it doesn't taste good. So when you're selling it, I'm like... And there's a silent, judgy look. And you can tell it's not being sold. Dad hasn't even said anything. And you know what do they say? وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ لَنَا. And you're not... We just know you're not going to believe us. You're not going to accept what we're saying. You would never do that. مُؤْمِنِ اللَّنَا. You're not going to give in to what we're saying. You're not going to accept what we're saying. وَلَوْ كُنَّا صَادِقِينَ. Even if we had been telling the truth. لَوْ is used for had been. That's the ظاهر of the text. Had we been telling the truth, you wouldn't believe us anyway. Y'all kind of gave it away, huh? Meaning we're not telling the truth. But you know what, Dad? Even if we were telling the truth, you wouldn't have believed us. Because you don't even trust us. So what's even the point of telling the truth? That's why I lie, Dad, because you don't believe me anyway. That's how psychotic people can get. That's how crazy things can get. They even gave them, they didn't say we're telling the truth. They said, you're not going to believe us. Even if had we been telling the truth, you still wouldn't believe us. There's another interpretation of had we been telling the truth. Or had we been truthful. Meaning, Dad, you never thought we're truthful anyway. And even if you thought we were truthful, even if you did trust us, because we know you don't trust us, so obviously we're telling you this, the truth of what happened, and you don't trust us. But even if you did think we were truthful, this story is too crazy for you to believe, even if you did trust us. And obviously you won't believe us now, because you don't trust us anyway. You know? This is rationalization. This is them rationalizing their behavior. And they're telling their dad, they kind of gave themselves away when they said, you're not going to believe us. And the idea, you're not going to believe us, came out way too quickly. Because you should not be concerned whether or not he believes you. The concern should be what? Yusuf and what just happened. Why is this even a subject right now? This is a subject right now because that's your priority. The priority was never Yusuf. Or what happened to Yusuf. Those feelings aren't even the problem for you. Because you did the crying act already. That part's not what you're trying to sell. You're trying to make sure he believes you. That's the more important thing to you. So you're not going to believe us? Had we even been telling the truth, you wouldn't believe us. As if now the dad, there's enough here to know that this is no good. This is just a bunch of, you know, baloney that they've come up with, and they're trying to sell it to him. Now, the thing is, I won't go too far with you in today's account because I want to take time to help you understand the father's response. But I will say one or two things before to introduce you to the father's response. And we're going to wrap up the father's response tomorrow, inshallah. And there's something exciting the day after, the surprise for you guys that I have planned. But for now, I will tell you one thing, you know, on this note. You know, وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ لَنَا وَلَوْ كُنَّا صَادِقِينَ. When they say this to their father, even had we been telling the truth, you wouldn't accept what we're saying anyway. And the father realizes that they're lying, and they kind of give themselves away anyway. And I haven't even talked to you. The next ayah is going to be about how they, you know, gave him a shirt with fake blood on it, with false blood on it, and tried to sell it as Yusuf alayhi salam's shirt. You know, some of us, you don't even say the shirt wasn't even ripped. Like, they forgot that detail. So, like, but even if we don't accept that, and we say they did a good job, I mean, I think they did pretty good dramatics from the beginning, so I think they may have ripped the shirt. My personal thought is they probably did make it look convincing, right? But one of them slipped. And my reading of وَلَوْ كُنَّا صَادِقِينَ also is not all of them said this, but maybe one or two of them slipped. Like when dad wasn't buying it. You know what, dad? Even if we were telling the truth, you wouldn't believe us. That's kind of, it just slipped out for one or two. That's kind of what happened. Because Allah is capturing all of them, not speaking in unison, but He's representing the entire communication as a whole in these words, right? A very common question that is asked about this story is, how come Yaqub alayhi salam heard all this and saw all this lousy evidence and this terrible testimony and saw right through it? In fact, he knew of their intentions even before they did anything. And all he can say is sabrun jameel. He just says, oh, beautiful patience. That's the English translation, right? Beautiful patience. Only Allah can help over the descriptions you're giving me. And the next thing you know, we're talking about Yusuf alayhi salam and the well, and story moves on. So you have this entire drama, and these young guys, you know, coming, making sure he's convincing, they're convincing to him, coming in the middle of the night, crying to him, giving him the story, giving him the shirt, and the dad just says, sabr, I guess. No. And that as a shallow read, that does sound like a very difficult thing to process. What parent would do that? What parent would do that? Like, think of it this way. If one of my sons got old enough to drive, and without my permission, he takes the car out, right? He takes the car around the block, and then who's going to find out? It's okay. And then as he's pulling in, he kind of hugs a tree a little bit, and my rear view mirror pops off, right? And then the car's in the driveway with the rear view mirror shaheed, right? And then he comes to me. The tree ran into the car, right? The car was right there, but the tree came in. A wolf. What am I going to say? Sabrun jameel, wallahu musta'an ala ma tasifun. I'm going to say, oh, I guess I just have to resort to beautiful patience. Only Allah can help over this description that you're giving me. I don't think so. And that's a rear view mirror. That's not a child. If there was a broken window in the house, you know, if there was a broken rear view mirror, if there was broken furniture, if there was damage, if there was, you know, a crack in the wall, something, I would lose it. I won't go crazy, but I'll at least say, no, you're going to have to explain what happened here. No, I want to know, and I would be upset. But I'm pretty sure my first words to the child would not be, sabrun jameelun, wallahu almusta'anu ala ma tasifun. Okay, anyway, what else is going on today? What are we having for dinner? Won't be like that. So it does beg the question, why isn't there more of a reaction from Yaqub alayhi salam? And I want to poke you with that question before we explore the answer to that question, inshallah ta'ala, tomorrow. Because I want to take my time with Yaqub alayhi salam's response and this final bit of the exchange. What's going to happen is, by ayah number 18, the ayah number 18 is the last we find ourselves in Canaan, meaning in that region where this story initiates. Now the camera is going to switch over, and we're going to be in Egypt. From the woods to Egypt is where we're going next. So tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala, we'll finish the part in Canaan, and you know, look at Yaqub alayhi salam's response, and then we'll do some tie up notes on what we've learned so far in 18 ayat by tomorrow, inshallah, before we move on to the part of the story that takes place in Egypt. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim, wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum al-ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.